Violence. Violence is defined as swift and intense physical force. And in the streets of Chicago, this type of physical force seems, well, common. Since the days of Al Capone, Chicago has been a gangster city. But what is the reason for this type of violence? It could be the lack of employment. Maybe the reason is that, from the 1970s to the early 2000s, there has been reported to be over 125 street gangs with no leadership. Maybe even because one of the easiest ways for young African American men to earn money in the streets is selling illegal drugs. Either way, our city is dangerous. And every day, we're just trying to be people surviving that danger.
Can you tell us a little bit about what happened to your son, Darius?
My son, Darius, he was 13 years old. He was playing basketball at the corner of 43rd and State Street, and he was shot during a drive-by shooting, which eventually took his life.
What were your first thoughts or reaction when you got that phone call about Darius?
Well, actually, when I first got the phone call about Darius being shot, truthfully, I just didn't think it was real because, you know, baby being shot, because, you know, that's what everybody called him. The two just didn't go together because he's only 13. So when I heard that, it didn't really ring true to me. So I'm thinking, okay, shot, perhaps a BB gun or something like that. But I never really thought it would lead to his death.
Since Darius' death, have you changed in any way?
Tremendously.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, for one, once you lose a child, your life is never the same. But instead of me just being sad all the time, I just choose to live in a way that Darius will be proud of me. But yeah, I have changed. I see things in a different way. I see the world in a different way. I try my best not to be angry and upset. But those are just real life factors. I mean, I've lost a child, so yeah, I'm hurting. I'm sad. But, you know, I am grateful that I do have other children. And we just try to be as positive as possible.
Do you still have memories about Darius?
Constantly, yes, constantly. One of my fondest memories was actually the day that he was murdered. I had cooked dinner just the way he liked it. I would even joke with him about the way I was going to prepare the chicken. He wanted me to fry the chicken, and I was joking with him that I was going to bake the chicken because it was so hot out that day. So when he left to go outside, he thought I was going to bake it, but when he used to come back in, he would find out that I had fried the chicken the way that he liked. But yeah, I got a lot of great memories of Darius.
Do you celebrate the day he passed away?
Yes, I do celebrate Darius's angelversary is what we call it, as well as his birthday. I still celebrate his birthday. And generally, on the day that he passed away, we usually go up to the park, well, you know, because you've been there, and do a balloon release. I go to the cemetery and I plant fresh flowers and everything and just try to remember him in a good way.
Do you feel empty without him?
There is a place in my heart that's empty, yeah. But it has been replaced with other things because when things like this happen in your life, God usually sends something else to fulfill you in different ways. It's not the same, and it's not to replace him, but it's just so that you're not totally void and empty. So yeah, so when Darius passed away, actually I went back to school. You guys were talking about psychology. I'm a psychology major, so I hadn't been back in the classroom in about almost 20 years, so that really helped me out a lot. It was a good distraction from everything that was going on.
Since the death, have you ever talked to a clinical psychologist?
Yes, I definitely have. As I told you, I'm a student at Roosevelt University, so I did seek help because you need to sit and talk to somebody because death is a really heavy thing, you know. I can't call you up every day and be crying and talking about Darius. Otherwise, people are not going to answer my phone calls after that. My parents, I mean, they're there for me, they support me, but unless you have really lost a child, you don't understand it. So, and I'm really grateful for my therapist too, because what she taught me to do was just focus on other things, but mainly just take care of myself, you know. Yeah, I'm gonna have those thoughts. I'm gonna wish he was here. I'm gonna miss him on holidays. I'm gonna miss him on his birthdays. I look at y'all when it's time to go back to school and I'm like, oh, I wonder what he would be doing and that and the other. So it's hard, but I have learned to just focus and channel that energy into something else.
What would be your advice to other parents that want the same thing?
You know what? It's different for everybody. Everybody's walk is different, but you know, it's a lot of cliches. It gets better with time. You got other children and that may not be the appropriate thing. So what I would do is just mainly listen to them, because you know, we all one step away really from a breakdown. You know, you just need one tragic situation a lot of times for us just to fall apart. So you really just got to gather your strength. Seriously, gather your strength. If you got a God, whoever you pray to, you got to dig deep within you and find your strength. And and I sit here as Darius's mother, but he has siblings. They going through the same thing. His dad going through the same thing. So, you know, it's different for everybody, but you just got to, this is the biggest fight of my life. I ain't never had to fight like this. It's been times I don't want to get out of bed. I don't want to see nobody, or I get outside and I got to go back in. That's part of the post-traumatic stress disorder that you guys are learning about. Like, I don't want nobody getting too close to me. You know, I'm looking around. I mean, it's really real. Can't sleep at night. So, you know, I just try to stay focused, be healthy, and just live a positive life.
Study shows there have been 347 homicides through November 9th. Last year, 414 people were murdered.
I'm 28. It was the worst experience of my life. My little god sister, India Martin, got shot and died from the bullet. Her and some girls was into it, arguing on Facebook. And the girl came to my friend's house. It could have been escalated from what happened, but we had grown-ups out there geeking it on. I was out there saving my goddaughter when the gun went off, and I didn't know my little sister was shot until I got in the house, and she took her last breath.
What way do you think
it could have turned out differently? I mean, if the little girl didn't have her aunties and her uncle, well, her uncle gave her the gun. But if her auntie wasn't in her ear telling her to pull the trigger, and you'd still be here.
Would you be interested in talking to a counselor?
Yeah.
Tell us why you think you might need a counselor. But how would that help you?
I mean, I done seen counselors before. Sometimes I think that don't help. Just not talking about it, because it's not gonna bring that person back. But sometimes always good to talk to somebody about it. So it might help, it may not help. I had nightmares. I dream about that almost every night. I could just sit up and just cry out the blue. But I don't know. I'll see where it goes from there.
And the U.S. youth homicide rates are more than 10 times that of other leading industrialized nations, on par with the rates in developing countries and those experiencing rapid social and economic changes.
Oh my god, Kim, she got shot! Oh my god! Somebody call the ambulance, let's call the police!
What actually happened? Were you in a crowd of people, or what happened that day?
We got out the car, me and Tania. to go speak to some people that I knew. And so it was a lot of kids outside. It was like a family event that they were having at their house, so it was a lot of kids outside. We were talking, and then it's me like, okay, we're gonna go. Like, you know, it was just a high and by. So we're walking, I'm leading them to the car, and when I got to the curb, like, everybody was behind me. And so something told me to turn around, and when I turned around, he was there, like, there.
Oh, really? How close to you?
I'd say about maybe 15 steps away.
Hmm.
Like, because we were, the curb, this is the curb, and the tree. There was some things separating us, but he was still close, and I was still trying to figure out how he got there. Like, yes, like, I couldn't. Wow. It was just, everything happened fast. Like, he was there, like, I shot, and then he stopped shooting all over my eyes, and then that's when everything was really breaking loose. The kids were, you know, running crazy, screaming. It was just.
So, were you like an innocent bystander?
Yeah.
He was shooting at somebody else.
That's the gist of it. We don't know why. We were all out
there. Still don't know.
Right. We were just out there having a conversation, and he appeared. Like, it wasn't like we were on the corner. That was their home, the people that I was going to talk to. So it was just like.
And so you felt it in your leg, you went down.
Yes, I felt like numbness. I couldn't feel it. Like, it was numb. Like, it didn't burn or anything until after they had me to get on the ambulance. That's when I start to feel pain. But before then, you just really, like, your adrenaline is still rushing. You just you just know you hit me. You just don't know exactly how to feel.
In your perspective was, and you're a friend, right?
Yeah.
What's your name?
Tanae.
Tanae, give me your perspective of what you experienced that day as a bystander.
Okay, I was shocked. I didn't even know if I was moving. I didn't even know when I got to the hospital after everything happened. I didn't even know how I felt until I looked at my picture. It was just shocking. I just felt like I was moving. So all I could see was dirt flying up, like the blood was just hitting the ground. And it was just, I was moving slow. I just didn't feel like I was moving. I thought she was just crawling. I didn't know she did shot. I thought she was just crawling, so I'm looking at her like, okay, she's good. But then, like, didn't stop. She was like, oh my God.
Mike.
Yeah.
You're Rakita's mom.
Yeah.
Tell us about your experience.
I don't really know what to say, but you don't want to get a call like that. That's not a call that you want to receive. Actually, Tania was the one who called me, and I actually didn't know what went on. I could just hear a bunch of hollering and screaming. It was a lot of static, and her area code on her phone wasn't an area code. It was a 24. It was some out of state area, but I answered anyway. And she just started hollering that Rakita got shot, and I said, got shot. I was like, where y'all at? You know, and that's what made me holler. And then she said she got shot, but she never said where. She never said nothing. And she started hollering, breathe, Rakita. It was just like everything. So I just prayed, and I just drove. It was a couple of blocks from my house. When I got to the crime scene, they wouldn't allow us to go there. They had it taped off, so they wouldn't allow me to go down there. And I could see Rakita from where I was standing at. So one of the officers came down there and told me, is that your daughter down there? I said, yes. She said, okay. She's been shot in the leg. It's called it a blowout, whatever that is. It went through, I guess, a blowout. I said, okay. So I felt a little bit better to know actually where she was shot at. So Rakita was still down there, and I called her on her phone. I called on her phone, and I told her, when you get in the ambulance, just let me know where you're going. I need to know where you're going. And then I found out, hearing the stories, because where I was standing, I was still around a bunch of bullet cases, was like everywhere, shells was everywhere, so they had to open up the crime scene some more. But from my understanding, I don't really know what happened. I know that my daughter don't hang out there. She just happened that day to go over there, and as me and Rakita talked about it, she said the way it was set up, whether she stopped over there or not, the way they had it set up, that was going to occur anyway, because she seen one guy when she turned to her right, to her left, but it was other guys shooting from the other side. So, and my concern was, I didn't really know how things was gonna go. I just know a lot of them here got shot. Then when I found out the one she was talking to, they killed him. then it was totally different, you know. And then Rakita was telling me all the stuff she had seen and different things like that. So I'm still trying to reach out to get her some therapy, you know, mentally. But I just prayed about, I think the Lord was more so, once I seen how things was going, he just put me at in a certain space to put me like at ease. I like doing everything on my own, so being restricted, like being on the wall.
It's okay, take your time. Because I know you were in a wheelchair for a while. Take your time.
You get a chance to see what it's like when you need help and when you need somebody to help you to do basically everything. I mean, I was able to do certain stuff like go to the washroom on my own, but as far as getting up and leaving, or the majority of my recovery time, I was at home, you know, in the bed. You couldn't really do nothing. So you get a chance to see what it's like to be restrained. And then I was so eager to get off my crutches. Like, I was so determined, so I think that helped with me recovering, because I was so ready to get back to doing everything that I do normally. And that's basically it. Like, recovering to me was the harder part, because it marinates more. Like, you know, you think about it more because you're realizing that that's why you're in the situation you're in. So you think about it a lot. But now, since I'm able to move around, I don't, you know, think about it as much. So
good.
Yeah. The youth homicide rate in the U.S. stood at 11.0 per 100,000, compared to France, 0.6 per 100,000, Germany, 0.8 per 100,000, the United Kingdom, 0.9 per 100,000, and Japan, 0.4 per 100,000.
So mental health is like as wellness. It's not to be compared to the health that we do, like when we're sick and we go to the doctor, as much as it is how are we thinking, how are we behaving, how are we feeling. And it is something that we need to make sure that we're constantly aware of and we're treating like anything else.
How do you feel about losing your oldest?
To be able to see him grow into young man, or graduate high school, college, have kids or family. It's hard to be here without it.
How does this event affect your life today?
I'm more afraid for the outside now. You know, it's not that anything will happen to you. I can't deal with other people. I've been asked, you know, okay, well, what kind of job do you want to get? And I think I'm going to be afraid more.
Something that affects us not only mentally, but also affects us emotionally. And sometimes we think about mental health and we only think of the thoughts. But trauma impacts not only our thoughts and our judgment, but our relationships, our behaviors, our moods, how we feel, not even how we feel about ourselves, but how we feel about our whole entire environment.
So it can be things that happened in the past, like that hunting too, that you think about often.
Yeah, and it's not that things that happened in the past that haunted you. It's things that happened in the past that continues to haunt you.
How do you feel
about the video that you recorded? Yeah. I can honestly tell you that if you record the video, I wouldn't call anybody to do this. So I think that it's sad that somebody the need to stand out there and record the things that were going on, but if they didn't, we wouldn't know what happened. So, I thank them.
Have you ever received any counseling, or would you like to be counseled?
I did counseling about it all kind of went so fast. It was like the brother that taped, this happened. He was murdered on Thursday, and on Sunday they had 3 people arrested. So the next Saturday we did his funeral, and then that following Wednesday we were in court, you know, and it went so fast. So I say it took me, I think I got to a point where I might have been having a nervous breakdown. I went to the doctor and she, you know, referred me to counseling. I did it for like 2 years, but now it's like they want to put you on medicine, and I'm trying to find me again without all of that, you know. Maybe one day I may go back to the doctor. But right now, I need to be focused on what's happening right now. No.
83 children, age of 16 or under, were murdered since January 1st, 2012, including 31 this year alone. 675 have been wounded, including 227 since January 21st this year.
Is PTSD to you, or what is it?
So to me, so since I am a counselor educator, PTSD to me is met with specific criteria. Mm-hmm. And there's 4 criteria. The first is exposure, and that's the threat of death or harm, and that kind of promotes fear and helplessness. The next is the persistency of the exposure, so those thoughts that happen all the time. Sometimes it's dreams, right? Sometimes you don't want to go to sleep because every time you go to sleep, you're hearing it.
Like why they occur.
Yeah. The next one is the avoidance or the numbing. You know, those people who just say that they don't feel anything, or they just avoid the situation altogether. And then lastly, is like the arousal or the lack of arousal. So maybe being what we call hypervigilant, or just like on edge. Like if you hear, maybe you experience gun violence. So if you hear a book fall onto the floor, you're gonna jump.
Yeah.
Right. and it has to be present for like at least a month after the event has happened. And it can last for just that little time, or it can last for a lifetime for some people.
How do you cure people with PTSD?
So the cure comes in as though there's something broken. Mm-hmm. And if we're talking about health and we're talking about wellness, we don't necessarily see it as a brokenness as much as maybe a readjustment. So I think there's 3 things. I think a belief, an understanding, and a practice needs to happen. The belief and understanding comes in when we address the problem. Right. And I think a lot of times we see ourselves trying to fix the violence. And I don't think we need to fix the violence as much as we need to create more solutions for the healing. So if we come at it from a back end and say, how do we prepare ourselves for danger? How do we prepare ourselves to overcome stress? Then we'll be prepared, because you can't stop somebody.
Right.
You know, somebody's going to be harmful, because there's so many environmental things. But I think what we need to reframe and refocus is looking at how we ourselves build up before, or even after, or in the face of all the other stuff going on. How do we build ourselves so that we're protected?
So it's like you like helping somebody that just broke a leg, getting back to walking on that leg.
Right, but instead of helping them when their leg is broken, we want to make sure that they're strong enough. So make sure that their immune system is up, and make sure that they understand exercise and healthy living, so that when they break their leg, it heals in a way that is in line with their lifestyle.
Well, how us using music today help people express their feelings, because I know that music helps people deal with everyday problems, or it might solve or soothe them in a way, like make them feel better. So like with people with PTSD, they probably don't or do listen to music. Would they help them better immune like with the problem, because music is soothing to me.
Yeah, music is soothing. Music can be good and bad depending on what side of the fence you're on. I'm on the good side. Mm-hmm. I think that, so traditional treatments for PTSD are medication, exposure, they call it exposure therapy, where you're slowly reintegrating them into like their world and their experiences, and medication. Mm-hmm. Are those things helpful? Yeah, probably, but why not use something that's natural? Kind of like the purpose and the value again. People find purpose and value in music all the time. You can probably think right now of your favorite song.
It
puts you in a place that's very comfortable. And with using music, we can utilize that with those who are maybe dealing with PTSD to put them in a place that's comfortable so that they can express, you know, the hurt in a way that they're developing a solution for. Mm-hmm. For them, from themselves, and not necessarily me saying, oh, I'm the expert, let me tell you how to deal with it, you know, but them kind of coming in and saying, you know, this is my experience and this is how I can relate to it in a way that I can find new purpose for myself again.
What's up, everybody? All right.
What's up?
Okay,
so
we're gonna talk a little bit. I know we got some musicians, we got some singers, we got some writers, we got some music, right? Yeah, yeah. I think we got some spoken word and rappers as well. Okay, good. So let me just say this. Music is a very powerful tool. I think you guys already know that. But what your generation really needs to understand is that you can take the music and you can take the songs and you can literally change the way people think. And that's what this particular program is about. It's about you guys really trying to teach your generation how to think differently, so that they don't end up in violent crime, so they don't end up in just bad situations. And how we really need to change the brain is we create something that's repetitive. You understand what I'm saying?
On my 14th birthday, I was robbed from my plane. I was in an accident down the street from my house. And it backed me because I had restless nights for about 4 or 5 days. I finally got over it.
My name is Shakoya Coates, and on August 3rd, 2011, a close friend of mine that killed Bang Gary Hiss, who was called him Baby. It was on 43rd day of drive-by shooting. It affected me in a bad way because like, it was real close. Anytime come on 43rd, you're looking forward to see Baby because he was wrong. Play ball, pick up a gun, energetic do. It's real hard to live a life that you didn't start. October 12th, 2014, I lost a cousin and my car to Running Man. I lost her to the time for me. Like, we just having a party and we transferred her home. It's like hurting me because now that I don't sleep, I dream of the day that he got killed by Inky Cops on my head.
Trying to escape the thought of your body.